upstairs at Froelich, show 324, real one.
Did you do 322?
Yes, I did.
We've been watching HBO Max last week, so we caught up. We rewatched all the new Christopher Nolan Batman movies. And once again, my opinion remains the same. Batman Begins is my favorite of the three. Dark Knight Rises is okay, but I think Aaron Eckhart doesn't get the attention he deserved because of Heath Ledger's death. And Dark Knight Rises was so fucking long. My God, you could have cut an hour out of that movie. It was so fucking long.
Eh, I'm not even going to debate because you know where I stand. I watched 30 minutes of Black Widow and said nope.
I have it. I'm probably going to watch it at some point. We've been watching the Marvel movies again over the summer. And we just finished, we're up to Age of Ultron. We finished that yesterday. You know, Age of Ultron is a movie I barely remember. I remember watching it the first time, but I don't remember all the details. Like, for instance, I had no idea that James Spader was the voice of Ultron. And then I'm watching it again, and I'm like hearing, oh, fuck, that's James Spader.
And then you didn't even see that meme I put up a while back from Tough Turf. Robert Downey Jr. and James Spader were in that.
Yeah, that's right. Well, they were also in another one, Less Than Zero, too, right?
Yep, Less Than Zero.
So
yep.
It's sort of a reunion, and maybe Robert Downey gave him the job.
Yeah, because like James Spader, I think when they were doing Age of Ultron, I mean, James Spader was still working. It was just like, hey, you're my old friend. Come do this movie with me. Why not? So what else did I watch outside of the movies we're reviewing?
But, you brought up Black Widow, and Black Widow is supposed to take place chronologically right after the events of Age of Ultron.
I'm fine with that. I just, like, I'm a weird type of person. Like, I like James Bond movies. Okay, I love James Bond movies. That's inherent because of my father, though. I think that's, like, an inherent thing.
Yeah.
But, like, espionage movies in general, I fucking hate them. Like, that's why I will not watch the Bourne movies. I could give two shits about them.
I'll probably get around to those at some point.
Captain America and the Winter Soldier is, like, my least favorite Marvel movie, and I know a ton of people who love it. They sing its praises, and I'm like, guys, it's a fucking espionage movie.
Well, yeah, that's also the fact, espionage. I think, that the Black Widow movie is kind of a flimsy rewrite or retread of Winter Soldier.
That's what I'm led to believe. Yeah. And like I said, dude, I could not get through that first half hour. It was just like, it was a snore fest.
I don't know.
I've seen this before. I don't care. And I guess at the end of the day, and again, I'm probably sounding facetious and I really don't care. I'm sorry. I like unbelievability. I don't want to see a movie about a human fucking character.
Well,
I'll
give you
Natasha at the end of the day is fucking human. Okay.
I'll give you unbelievability there in the shape of the Taskmaster, who they got a male stunt double to do all those ridiculous stunts. And then they do this shocking quote unquote reveal that it's just a woman under the mask. There's your unbelievable aspect of the whole thing. There's also the whole practicality of giving all these women hysterectomies when all you could do is just hire men. Instead, I mean, it's some kind of a weird sex trafficking thing. So there's obviously some kind of a political statement going on with the movie. But my biggest gripe is it's a $200 million movie that does not look like a $200 million movie. It looks like it was shot in abandoned warehouses. It does not have the production design or values of the Avengers movies or even any of the other previous Marvel comics.
I guess what we're trying to say at the end of the day is it probably would have worked better as a TV show.
I think it would have worked better 10 years ago. It is way too late. Black Widow's dead. There's really no reason for an origin story.
Yeah, I know,
Widow back then. I really loved her as a character.
The only reason this movie exists is because even though it takes place before Infinity War, yada, 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 things happen in this movie that lead up to Phase 4, and it's like they're roping you into fucking watching it just because you need some relevance for later on. And it's like, guys, I don't want to watch this garbage movie.
Is there some kind of like a connection to the what's the first movie to come up that, or the next movie is something about the Legend of the Seven Golden Rings or some shit?
Well, yeah, like the Tang.
And then Loki, as we know, leads into Doctor Strange for some reason.
But yeah, but dude, Loki, that ending of Loki was such a cock
tease. Don't ruin it. Well, don't ruin it for me yet because watching it.
I wasn't going to ruin it for you.
We're watching it tonight.
It was a fucking cock tease of an ending. And you're like, God damn it. Fucking Doctor Strange needs to come out now. have you seen before we get started again, have you seen the newest clip for the Suicide Squad?
No, I have not.
I fucking died laughing.
Is it good?
It was on Kimmel. It was a King Shark scene and just Stallone playing the ultimate dumbass. And it was one of the funniest minute and a half scenes I'd ever seen in my life.
So it's good. It's good then.
It's going to be a great movie.
Okay, good. Because, you know, the first, that other Suicide Squad is...
Wrong director. They got the wrong film. I already told you.
It just didn't seem... And that whole thing that's kind of leading off in a weird splinter way where you started with... Well, you kind of started actually with Deadpool first, and then you went on to Suicide Squad, and then you go into Harley Quinn. These movies don't look as good, you know, these newer ones. And I'm hoping that James Gunn does this, because, you know, we watch Guardians too, because we're, like I said, we're up to Age of Ultron. Guardians, James Gunn is like the main component of that success right there.
Yes, he is, and that's why he's going to be the big success that the DCEU needs, because...
If they keep him, because...
Like we've said, dude, this guy has had a career in Hollywood for almost 30 years, okay? And this is the first time he's ever gotten...
He's one of the few left who actually has experience. They keep hiring all these people who have no experience, like the lady who directed Black Widow. She's got, like, four little tiny movies to her credit.
And dude, James Gunn trained under Uncle Floyd, okay? Any movie he makes, I will watch. And again, like I said... He's waited almost 30 years to get that blank check from fucking a studio to let him say, make your movie the way you want to make it. Here's a blank check. No restrictions.
That's right.
Like, he got Final Cut, and God damn it, he deserved more than anybody.
Yeah, even
he was a filmmaker
when they tried to cancel
deserved.
Him, too. They tried to cancel him just because he said some shit on Twitter.
But
he's no Joss Whedon.
he's no Joss Whedon. Now, I was going to say, though, speaking of comic book heroes and comic book people.
Marvel.
I think we're talking about the original comic book heroes, right?
Yes. Superhero music band, if you will. That's the description.
Superheroes. Gene Simmons, I'll give this man some credit. An immigrant who was smart enough to get into comic books and science fiction and bad movies at a young age to where he came up with a great fucking idea for a band. And you know what? Good for him, because it's stuck for almost 50 fucking years.
Don't count out the other three. They all came together and formed this band together.
Oh, they did. Hey,
remember,
hey,
okay.
It would not have happened, but it's Gene and Paul's brainchild.
Yeah, but
no. Peter...
Don't let the Kistery thing try to influence this. They did all come together with this. They did find this band. They found it together. Gene and Paul were in a band called Wicked Lester, and then they got together and they put out ads. They brought in Peter Criss, and then they brought in Ace Frehley, and then they became something. They were nothing unless it was all four of them together. That's the most important thing that needs to be considered. There's also Bill O'Coin, who is an executive producer of the movie that we're going to talk about, which is Kiss Meets the Phantom of the Park, or Attack of the Phantoms, as it's known in Europe, which is what I saw. So it all sort of came together with Neil Bogart, who formed Casablanca, and... You know, they wore makeup. They screw around wearing makeup because it was a glitter rock scene in New York in 1973, 74. So they all brought various things. If Gene and Paul try to ever tell you that they fired Peter or fired Ace, they're fucking lying. Those were founding members. They had a personal interest and stake in the band. And they continued
to
make money.
Peter, the only one I could believe that anyone got fired was probably Peter, because even they said... His drumming started to slip after Love Gun.
Well, I don't really know. I don't know the details legally, but if it's a democracy and it's a three votes to one or something like that.
I don't know. The story on paper is that Peter Criss messed up his hands in a car accident during the Dynasty sessions.
Something like that.
And the producer of the record, Vinny, whatever his last name is,
Vinny Poncia, who produced Peter's, solo.
And that's what's even more funny about it, because Vinny Poncia said, yeah, guys, Peter's not up to snuff here. Let's bring in this South African guy.
Let's bring in Anton
Figg,
who is Ace Frehley's guy. He was in Ace Frehley's solo album and played on it. And,
they liked his drumming enough to where they put him on.
Anton Figg is a great drummer. He's fantastic. He was David. He was in the Paul Schaefer band, you know, for David Letterman, right? Mm-hmm. And he was a drummer for Frehley's Comet, and he's just a wonderful drummer.
But at the same time, Ace and Peter were having substance abuse problems. This is on paper.
I suppose. It's
they were having problems during, like, you got to remember, look what happened during Kiss Meets the Phantom of the Park. Just not to get too off topic, you've got the really bad stunt double for Ace, which is played by an African-American.
A big guy.
That's number one. And then Peter Criss's voice was dubbed in post because,
I've heard so many conflicting stories about that. I've heard that Peter did show up for looping, but for some reason they didn't like his voice. Because there were too many that I heard.
I also heard a story where he didn't show up for looping, where he didn't show
that
up.
That was
for post.
Paul. Paul would say that. The thing about this is you can't trust any of these four to ever tell you the truth. What I want to do is dispel some of the myths, because I don't necessarily believe all the stories that are told. I've seen every iteration of every story. I've heard a lot of crazy stuff. Well, let's get into the movie first. What was it, NBC that it was on?
Yeah, it was on NBC. I can't even remember. It was 1978. That 1978? Much I know. You were alive. I was not. You were six. I was a twinkle in my dad's left testicle at that time.
I will say I did not see it when it first aired because I wasn't quite a young. I was too young to actually have been a fan. I didn't become a fan until the next year, 1979. But
incidentally, though, not to cut you off, I heard that they only aired it on TV again one other time, and it was in like either 85 or 86.
They might have rerun it just as part of the regular rerun season in 78, like in around a holiday or some stuff, because it was the highest rated television movie of the year. I think only Roots, the miniseries, got any higher ratings than that.
Yeah, so was the Star Wars Holiday Special. Look how that turned out.
Yeah, but people watched it. That was all it was about, though. It was just getting people to watch, no matter how stupid. And we just watched it tonight.
The whole movie existed to keep KISS relevant, basically.
I guess. Well, I mean, but they had five. They released five records in 1978. The four solo albums and double platinum, right?
Right, and then Alive 2.
Oh, Alive 2 was 77. That was a previous.
Oh, that was 77. Okay, but like,
they released two records every year.
The whole reason they even did the movie is because I think it was Bill O'Coin who said that they had gone as far as they could go currently, and if in an effort to not remain stale, they should just do this movie and portray themselves as larger-than-life superheroes like they are. Like, right. Actually, they are KISS. They're not just four guys behind makeup. They are KISS. They're comic book heroes. You know, and I've said this before on this show many a times, and I will damn well say it again. Just like communism, the idea looked good on paper.
Well, yeah, I guess. But watching it now, we watched it this evening with our meal and everything. There are certain flaws in the movie.
Certain. Oh, you mean certain? Don't you mean total?
there are certain flaws. I mean, like, well, the whole thing was put together, right? I noted a couple of names in the cast. I mean, Anthony Zerbe is
Anthony Zerbe, and you know what?
You know,
I watched it last night. I will give Anthony Zerbe all the credit in the world.
Anthony Zerbe is a trooper. He is a total trooper.
Yes,
this guy is a pro. He's a professional. He is acting his heart out in this piece of shit television movie starring a rock band. He is acting his titties off, and he's doing like fucking Alas, Poor Yorick. I knew him, Horatio. He's doing this Shakespearean thing in this movie, and he's acting opposite KISS, and it's a paycheck. I guess I hope he was paid really well. I really do.
I would assume, for a TV movie, I would assume he was paid pretty good for his time. But, I mean, he gave it his all, and I'm glad about that. But, you know, that's literally the only high point in the acting.
Wait. How about our boy, Brian James?
Brian James, an unknown at the time, using that little hackneyed voice. Another talent he has where he's just, I think he's probably using his natural voice. I can't really tell.
Yeah, he is. But he's also got his patented dorky face. He almost looks like Leon.
Yeah, with longer hair, though.
Mm-hmm.
Where do we go on the strength of the acting
from the band
members?
Oh, well, that's easy. Gene Simmons was born to be an actor. He has an actor's persona. He has an actor's presence. He can make it work, even though they put that stupid effect under his voice.
Yeah, that reverb on his voice. That was like, I get that he's a fucking demon, but why do you need to add reverb?
Now,
that
Peter is different because it's not his voice. They got this guy who does a lot of voices for Hanna-Barbera cartoons. I forgot his name. It's somewhere in the Wikipedia. But they got him to loop Peter's voice. So Peter's trying to act. I guess he's being expressive because he has a kitty cat face. You know that. As for Ace and Paul, Paul is from Brooklyn and Ace is from the Bronx, and you can hear it in their voice, and it's so obvious, you know.
Ace for
you're
what he was,
for
he
someone,
wasn't that
but
bad.
It's not
Ace was not that bad. Paul is atrocious. Paul is horrible.
Ace is like, you know, he's like, first off, he keeps saying "act" all the time, right?
Right.
And then he says insufficient data at the moment, star child. You know,
well, like I like the one scene out of nowhere where Gene comes in and goes, "Hey, Carly."
He's like, "Hi, Carly." That's because, I mean, like, according to the story, according to a Paul Stanley story, or maybe it was Gene Simmons, I'm not sure, but the writers, Jan Sherman and Don Boudet, were tasked with hanging out with the four members of the band by themselves to get an idea of their character so they could write the script around the characters. Ace didn't really say anything. All he said was, "Ack," and "Hi, Curly," and they just wrote it in. And then later, when Ace saw the script, he's like, "How come I don't have any lines?" And so they rewrote it and gave him lines.
But yeah, and it was kind of unfair because you go off the lines. It's like Ace has the least, then Gene has second least. I would say fucking Peter Criss actually has the most lines out of the whole damn thing.
He might, yeah.
And even though, and ironically enough, this is the voice that's fucking dubbed over.
Yeah.
But, you know, the whole plot of this movie screams of bad fucking cinema, you know?
What is the story exactly? Okay, Kiss is visiting, Kiss is going to play.
Kiss is.
At the amusement park.
Tell the story.
Well, they're going to play gigs at the Magic Mountain Amusement Park or something. The park is run by, this Italian dude, I guess, and he's got this guy Abner Devereaux, who like does all their animatronic stuff, which is all their, I guess, you know, their automated dummies or whatever, you know, kind of a wax museum vibe, but they move. He's got, for some reason, he's got a laboratory 150 feet below the surface of the amusement park where he designs all these machines, and so he finds himself being downsized because apparently he costs too much money and they want to get rid of him and bring in, I don't know, something else. He wants to do all these historical things, historical monuments, like he wants to put on a performance of Hamilton or something. A bunch of characters from the 1700s jerking each other off or something like that.
Yeah, and he's pissed off because they go, "You took this great amusement park, and now all you want to do is show a Kiss concert."
Mm-hmm.
And then his whole thing is...
He's like
Kiss
Ultron, okay?
Magical, yeah.
I pointed this out to my wife and child. I said, this is basically Age of Ultron, because he wants to create a whole bunch of a replica army of... Android machines or kind of Stepford machines or something like that. And he starts with this guy, Sam, who's his assistant, who is, the girl, Melissa, I think is her name.
Yeah.
Her boyfriend, their fiance. And she's like looking around for him. Apparently she enlists the help of Kiss, or they volunteer to help or whatever. And they have these magical talismans.
Well, yeah, because like there's the scene after they play the show. Then you hear Star Child. And then he goes, "You are not here to see Kiss. Who are you here for?"
He's like, "You're looking for someone, but it's not Kiss."
Not Kiss.
Which is like, that's Paul Stanley doing his thing.
Yeah. Of course, but,
so, I don't know. They're wandering around in the amusement park at night for some reason. I guess they sleep during the day. And they wind up getting into fights with these bizarre... There are these white munchy cheese or whatever they are that fight them and attack them. And
yeah, right by the roller coaster and everything like that.
I wanted to mention that in the European release, it's not on your release, it's not on the original World Vision VHS tape.
Okay.
They added songs. They took out a lot of the incidental music during all the fight scenes and all the walking around scenes, and they replaced it with songs from the solo albums from 1978.
You hear
a bunch of like Gene Simmons solo album songs, Peter Criss, Paul Stanley, and Ace Frehley songs running on the soundtrack, and it's kind of haphazardly put because... It doesn't make much sense. But I don't know if it's an improvement over the Hanna-Barbera music, because that stuff just sounds like...
Yeah, that's that cheesy porno-grade music.
It's kind of like out of a cartoon, yeah.
If I could surmise as to why they did that, so the big thing is Kiss was big in America at the time, but overseas they weren't that... Like, they were hot, but they weren't that hot. So I think the reason they put the solo album music in there was because I think they sold the movie overseas and it got played theatrically.
Theatrically. Matter of fact, that's weird because, this one that I watched, I don't know what the aspect ratio, was it 4:3 on your Laserdisc?
Yeah, it was shot 4:3. Like, you
this
gotta remember,
was a
all
16
these,
to
all
9
these
or 185
seven,
to 1. It was like
yeah, all screen. These 70s flicks were all shot for TV and they were all cropped for the theaters. Like, another example, again, I don't want to go too far off. I want to stick with the script. But V was one example to where it played on TV over here, but it played in theaters over there. And then the original Salem's Lot, Toby Hooper, it was, you know, filmed in 4:3, shown here on television,
and
shown
in
theaters.
Yeah. Yeah, they cut it down. That was a really bad one, too, because they took a 3-hour
movie.
And
that was funny with that. That was the version that was, like, on circulation and on videotape for a while here, you know, before DVDs ever came out.
Yeah.
Because, like, the only way, I think... If you got an original VHS, like a 2-tape VHS, you got that. any of the single tapes were always the condensed European version, and the laser disc was the only way you could get to see it in like its full original glory with the bumpers.
I have the Salem's Lot Blu-ray with the full miniseries. I advise everyone to watch that because that is the best version.
It is.
And that's a really good one, too, actually.
The only complaint I had, I did a review on my YouTube channel a while ago. I said, while I praised, you know, the restoration and everything, the only disappointment I had was they took out, you know, the bumpers for, you know, night one. Like, because, you know, when it aired in two separate nights. You got a set of end credits. And then, you know, the movie started back up with a recap. And then you got a new opening title sequence. And then... I wish they would have retained that for the Blu-ray. Instead, what they did was they ran it together like one whole thing. But unlike Stephen King's It, you weren't missing any scenes that were detrimental to the plot.
Yeah.
So having said that, back to Kiss. I was saying that I think the reason they added the solo songs in there was to gain, like, those albums weren't doing too well over here. Like, it shipped platinum, but they were returned just as quick, you know. They figured, hey, let's put these songs in here to expose these people overseas to this music, and then maybe we can sell these records in the foreign market and recover some money here, you know?
I think they did. I think they managed to do that, because I remember Kiss suddenly getting, they were starting to get popular in the 80s in Europe. As they were waning popularity here, they got famous. Like, Lick It Up was really big in Europe.
Because I think the last tour, I think it was the Dynasty Tour, was one of the last ones they had over here for a while.
Yeah.
And then, like, in the early 80s, like, I'd say in between 80 and 83, they were mainly touring overseas.
Yeah,
like, they were doing Australia, Japan.
They did one show in New York just to introduce Eric Carr at the Palladium in 1980. And then they went to Australia and New Zealand. And they didn't tour for Elder at all because it was a big, enormous flop. Then they had an abbreviated Creatures of the Night tour here before going off to Brazil and doing the three shows there. And then when the Lick It Up tour happened, then they came back. And they basically, for 3 years, they didn't tour in the United States.
Yeah, well, I mean, Dynasty, while it's not a terrible record, one could argue as
I enjoy it. I think it's great.
I think it's a good record too, regardless. But
it's a great record, but it's not Kiss. You know, I mean,
it's not Kiss.
Yeah,
the cracks were starting to form. I'd say probably one of the few like actual Kiss songs out of there is probably Magic Touch or Charisma. Like those.
The only one that Peter Criss played on was Dirty Livin', his song.
Yeah,
that was the only one that he played on. That was pretty much the end of it.
And I do like 2000 Man.
2000 Man is awesome. That is like the best cover of a Rolling Stone song I ever heard.
Yeah. So, aside from that, though, it's like, you know, they did this movie just to, you know, maintain their popularity.
It was kind of,
unfortunately, it hurt them more than it helped them.
Well, we're going to get into this, of course, because we do have a Kiss podcast planned where we're going to talk about the various eras. But this much I can tell you, 1978, part of this was the corporatization, as I called it, the corporatization of the band. They started out as something very close to the kind of like glitter or glam rock of the early 70s in New York, you know, like the New York Dolls, bands like that, with all the makeup and the lipstick and the high heels and all that stuff and kind of this androgynous tone. Then it started to become more because of Beth. I blame Beth, basically. Beth from Destroyer brought in more girls, and then more girls brought in more kids, and then it became a circus act. So it turned into this thing that it was never supposed to be, and this was built part of Bill O'Coin's whole plan for the band. What should have really been done was something that avoided all of these pits. Everybody wanted to leave. I don't know why. Maybe just hanging around with Gene and Paul was just making Peter and Ace crazy or something, because they like to party hard, and I guess Paul did party hard, but he wasn't a teetotaler the way Gene was. He was just kind of more of a really sensitive dude or something. So he wanted everybody to get along, whereas Gene was like really judgmental and kind of hypercritical of Ace and Peter's antics, and that'll cause a lot of tension too in the band, you know. And the thing is, they didn't like to talk about it, but Ace was pretty much really popular because of his solo record. His solo record was enormously popular. It was much more popular than anything else. They gave him more songs on Dynasty on a Mass as a result of that, you know. So he was getting to be more popular, and he was getting outvoted now. And then after Peter left, he didn't want to do the Elder, so he left, you know. And it could have been something more, but...
Well, then one of the main things was it was kind of like how, Eric Carr... Like, after Eric Carr joined the band, because they always, you know, they said they always treated it like a democracy when it was the original four guys. They took a vote, majority rules. But then when Eric Carr was in Kiss, he didn't get a full vote because
he didn't get a vote. He was an employee. Even though he, you know, in my opinion, I mean, I do dig Peter Criss. I like his jazz leanings and what he did. And also my friend Melissa is his niece, you know. I don't want to say too much about Peter, but I always dug Eric Carr more because Eric Carr came from a more heavy metal kind of Led Zeppelin thing. I always liked that. He's very John Bonham, you know. He's got a John Bonham thing going on.
Because then it got as soon as Eric Carr joined the fray, like, their sound just went, like, from 70s to straight 80s hair metal. And that was a good thing for them. That was a very good thing.
It was good, but it didn't happen quite in time. If they had really, they could have done that. Oh, man, you know.
As much as you love Elder, that album should have never fucking happened. They should have just, like.
Elder destroyed them. I mean, like, Elder, if they had gone straight into Creatures or that Killers. Did you listen to Killers yet?
Yeah, I've heard it once or twice. I know that Killers is mainly a compilation album. There's a couple of tracks
Four, I think, or two. I don't know if it's four. Yeah, maybe four tracks on there that are, like, tracks they were working on before they decided to do, hey, let's do the Elder instead. You know, these tracks could have been the preamble to the beginning of what could have been the heavy metal part of Kiss's heyday in the 80s, you know?
Mm.
That could have happened, but they decided not to. I don't know why they didn't do that, why they did this Elder thing, but, you know.
But that's, you know what, that's another discussion for another time.
There's a lot of, I mean, there's so many problems, and so Kiss Meets the Phantom of the Park is like this, it's just a mess because it's just such a badly made, it's so shockingly badly made.
Yeah, for like a television movie. Like, whoever they hired, they didn't hire anybody. Dude, it's even shot terribly.
Well, I mean, yeah, Gordon Hessler, though, is the director of this movie, and he started out in Hammer. I mean, he made Hammer horror films, you know? That was his background. They actually hired this guy. This guy had experience working in Hammer, right?
Right.
And it was shot by Bob Caramico, who started out working with, you know, making these, like, exploitation films back in the 50s and 60s, like nudie flicks and shit. I think Caramico, he shot Orgy of the Dead, which was written by Ed Wood in 1968. He, like, shot that movie. But he shot a whole bunch of other stuff. He worked in television mainly.
Okay, so that makes plenty of sense as to why the movie wasn't even shot all that well. I mean,
I don't know. You know, the photography of Orgy of the Dead isn't the worst thing about it. But the worst thing about it is there's no story, you know?
You're making a made-for-TV movie with literally the hottest band in the world at the time. No pun intended, because they were always called that. Whatever.
Yeah.
But you'd figure you'd want to put a little money and a little bit of talent behind the camera and, you know, in the special effects department, this and that. I can admire what they tried to do with this, you know. But at the end of the day, all that Kiss Meets Phantom of the Park is a notoriously bad fucking cash grab.
I love Ace Frehley. I love Ace Frehley in this movie so much.
I do. Especially I really like Ace in this.
They open
really
up the talisman.
Too.
She's like, what's that music playing? He goes, Beethoven's Fifth. He's got that insane laugh, you know, that Tom Snyder laugh, you know?
Yeah.
Well, actually, I'm a plumber.
But you're kind of like a spaceman, huh?
No, actually, I'm a plumber.
On the side. No, well, listen, I got a little piece of pipe backstage I'd like to have you work on.
Tell me about it.
This movie is just...
I play a trout.
It's something else, and I feel bad for the people out there, especially you, who can't see it in its original TV version.
Well, I'm sure we can find it somewhere. What I would really like to know, you're the aficionado, are we ever going to see a Blu-ray release of the original American version?
Never.
Why not?
As long as Gene and Peter, as long as them four guys are still fucking alive, specifically Gene and Paul, that ain't never happening. It ain't never going to happen. They want to bury it.
All right.
Hey, we were lucky enough to get a version of it on that fucking Kissology box set. You know, it's kind of like what George Lucas did with the theatrical cuts of the Star Wars movies. You know, he threw them on as a bonus and they were were Laserdisc Masters. Kiss was just like, you know what? Here's the European print. Fuck it. Let's give these fans something. All the fans are like, no, we want the TV version. We want the one we saw in 1978.
I have a message for my friend Melissa. She's my very good friend. I love her to death. She's Peter Criss's niece, and I gave her something to, because she went and spent the weekend at Peter's house in Long Island or something, whatever. At the time, a while back, I gave her a jigsaw puzzle that was basically the solo album covers, and he signed it for me. And he signed it. He wrote Peter Criss, and he put his little trademark 3 there, and it's in my basement right now, and I've never opened it up. She asked me to see my World Vision VHS tape of Kiss Meets the Phantom of the Park. I lent it to her, and she never gave it back. Melissa, if you're listening to this podcast, which I know you are because we're talking about this right now, please, can I have my tape back? I want my tape back, please.
Because I don't think he wants to buy that shitty Good Times VHS, let alone spend like $250 to $300 on the Laserdisc.
I think Well, I mean, you know, I remember when I bought it, too. I bought it in 1989. It was $8.99, and I think I bought it at either Sam Goody or Tower or something. For some reason, they re-released it on VHS, so I grabbed it. I was like, holy shit, I've never had this before. So I grabbed it. I got it for $8.
I think the reason it got released because World Vision was doing a lot of the Hanna-Barbera cartoons on VHS at the time. So since Kiss Meets the Phantom of the Park was a Hanna-Barbera production, it got put out. World Vision had the rights to it, so they were like, well, Image did the Laserdisc.
Laserdisc is the one. That is the Laserdisc version of my VHS.
Yep, because it has the same World Vision cover. Logo in the corner.
Yeah, and the same exact cover, too, which is...
And then the reason it got a Good Times release is because when World Vision changed hands, because Spelling had that for a while, and then he changed the name of the company, or it changed hands, whatever, That's when Good Times ended up releasing all the Hanna-Barbera shit in the budget bins, you know, in grocery stores and Kmart's during the fucking 90s. That's where you could get the LP tape of Phantom of the Park for like $5 or $6.
All right.
And I had that tape, too. I had that tape. It was garbage.
Anyway, Melissa, please, if you're listening, I love you. I love you, okay? I still love you. I still love you. You know, I love you, okay? Please, give me the tape back, please. I'm crying over here. I'm crying. I want it! I don't want to watch the European version anymore. The European version is... If you thought the American version made no sense, the European version makes even less sense. Okay. They changed it around. They changed all the... Oh, it's just really bad. Anyway, let's move on. We're going to do... Detroit Rock City, which, okay.
All right.
Now, this one isn't that, okay, I'm going to have to say this one isn't that much better than Kiss Meets the Phantom of the Park. Because...
Now, I got a little story to tell before we go into it.
Okay.
So, this is the movie that made me a Kiss fan.
Okay.
I had only ever heard maybe one or two Kiss songs before. I had just thought they were a bunch of clowns in makeup.
Well, they kind of are.
Again, I am a dumb 17-year-old kid in the late 90s, so don't give me too much hate. But,
yeah, and I'll bet you listen to Rush, too, don't you?
Yeah, no, I do listen to Rush, goddammit. Just whatever. Point is, I had just gotten my first DVD player in right around Christmas, like Thanksgiving, Christmas time, 1999, and I wanted to buy some new DVDs. I went to my local Circuit City and... South Park the movie and Detroit Rock City had just come out. I think I paid $19.99 for Detroit Rock City and $29.99 for South Park. Those were the fifth and sixth DVDs I ever bought. The only reason I bought Detroit Rock City, only reason had nothing to do with Kiss, is because of the guy who fucking made it, Adam Rifkin.
Adam Rifkin. I thought you were going to say Ron Jeremy.
No, Adam Rifkin, because he made another underrated fucking comedy classic known as The Chase.
The Chase,
with
yes.
Charlie Sheen and Christy Swanson.
Also Ron Jeremy.
Ron Jeremy.
He was in it, too. For some reason, Adam Rifkin just puts John Jeremy in everything.
Let the record show that I bought Detroit Rock City not as a Kiss fan, but as an Adam Rifkin fan. But when I saw this movie, I honestly, when I saw this movie, I was blown away by it. I was just like,
I knew
holy
who,
shit, this is an Adam Rifkin movie to the core, and it has Kiss music, and holy shit, Kiss is fucking awesome. I went out to my local record town a couple of days later. I bought like 5 or 6 Kiss CDs because they were all $5.
Oh, cool.
They were all the the new remasters had come out, like the 97 remasters had come out at the time.
Yeah.
But then they were trying to dump the old stock. Like,
oh, they were trying to dump
the
old
masters.
Ones?
Yeah, they were.
I still have those
old
masters.
Ones.
So they just basically put them in a bargain bin.
Yeah, they were all $5, dude. Like, I picked up Love Gun, Rock and Roll Over, Destroyer, the first album. I just picked up like the main records. I ordered Dress to Kill through the record club for 99 cents. But whatever, like that was the movie that got me into Kiss. Like, I would have never.
Well, they basically.
Kiss
I mean, okay.
That movie, man.
Just a minor little diversion there. There's not much difference between the remasters and the original stock. It's just that they put it through Q Sound mixing and they added new liner notes and new packaging. That's basically all they did.
That's what I figured. They don't sound like really punchy super remastered when you listen to them.
Yeah, just a little more.
They're a little cleaner. They're a little cleaner.
I would say they're probably best heard out of a series of speakers rather than just two speakers. I think that's the main difference. What I wanted to say about Adam Rifkin was I knew who he was because I had seen this movie that he made with Judd Nelson called The Dark Backward, and I was absolutely blown away by the visual style. I thought this is a movie that was made for no money. It had an incredible visual sense to it. And I said, this guy's going to go places. Unfortunately, he didn't really go places. But I got a preview, a free pass to see The Chase. So I went to see that at the Beekman. Really enjoyed it. Again, had a lot of fun. Got a program. It was a pretty cool thing. And then, like later on, he gets the opportunity to direct Detroit Rock City. At the time, I guess I don't know how this project came together, but it came together just at the time when Kiss reunited to do their Psycho Circus thing, right?
Well, yeah, because the whole movie was done by Gene Simmons. He produced it. The reunion happened in '96. They did the Unplugged in '95. And I think they just had to say, it's like, hey, let's make an actual Kiss movie. Like, let's try to do it right this time.
But they sort of, the thing about the movie is it kind of reminds me of an episode of That 70s Show. And there was an episode of That 70s Show that featured Kiss. Because Kiss had an entire Sunday night block of programming on Fox. They even appeared on an episode of Millennium with Lance Henriksen. So they had already done that to some degree either in 99 or 2000. This movie comes out in 99. And it's trying to do the same thing that 70s Show does. And there's even looks like Eric Foreman's mom, you know? Except she's like a horrible religious zealot or something.
I think one of the things they tried number one, first and foremost, the movie borrows heavily from Dazed and Confused.
I was going to say not that. My wife had a better comparison. She said it is almost identical to Rock and Roll High School. With the Ramones.
No. Dude, and I'm a diehard Rock and Roll High School fan.
I think it is because it is about PJ Souls trying to get tickets to the Ramones show.
Okay, you can, yes, that's essentially, but here's, the, but dude, the thing
this
is.
This whole thing
the
is
Ramones
just a bunch
the Ramones
of.
Ramones are all in the fucking movie, not in the last 3 minutes.
That's true, and they are in the shower with PJ Souls too, singing to her.
Yes,
but,
okay. And
yeah,
and
I know, that's
same...
that's kind of a ripoff because this is supposed to be a Kiss movie. We only see them for like 2 minutes in a truncated version of Detroit Rock City. It's kind of a ripoff.
Yeah, so, I mean, I get the comparisons, but no, I wouldn't even say. The idea, maybe?
Yeah,
a
I know.
Movie
Rock and
a band,
Roll High
okay.
School Rock and
but
Roll
High
School,
school ripped
had more
off fucking
of...
a Hard Day's Night, though. Rock and Roll High School ripped
kind
off
of,
Hard Day's
except,
Night.
I don't know. Hard Day's Night, the Beatles really were the star of that movie, weren't they?
Yeah.
The Ramones were definitely in Rock and Roll High School. They were all over that movie, and this was just sort of not quite that. But it is the same kind of spirit of trying to get to a concert. All the authority figures hate you. All of them don't approve. They don't speak your language, and they think it's interesting because they say things like Kiss are devil worshippers. And they didn't really start talking like that about the band until the early 80s. I want to say 81 when The Elder came out is when I started hearing stories about Kiss being devil worshippers or something.
See, I wouldn't know. I wasn't there.
Yeah, I know. You weren't even alive yet. But yeah. Oh, did you know Kiss Satan worshippers? It's kids in Satan service or knights in Satan service, right?
Yeah.
There are some things. There's a really, I don't know, it's when they're playing like Love Gun in the credits, in the opening credits, and they're showing you kind of a brief history of the 70s. It's not exactly my time because I was like 5 years old. It's supposed to take in 77 is supposed to take place.
78.
I want to say 77 because they're.
They even
they're
say 78.
But their costumes are strictly out of Love Gun, though, right?
Well, because this was during the Love Gun tour. Okay, I did a little IMDb history. They said that Kiss did go to Michigan in January of 1978
okay,
for
so
the Love Gun tour.
It's still January of 78 might as well be 77 because it's right
might as
the
well
beginning.
Be might as well be
it is that time
and I made sure to check on GPS to I mean because okay first and foremost let's get this out of the way. The movie was shot in fucking Canada. Okay, let's get that out of the way.
Well, no, so, I saw in the credits though they did thank the city of Detroit
because they got to use the name or Cobo Hall or whatever.
I don't even know.
That
we didn't
whole,
even
that
see
whole scene
Cobo
where
Hall.
They're in, that whole scene where they're downtown, that's Ontario.
So that whole okay. Thing. Okay, yeah. All right.
So the
that
main
makes
thing
sense. It is a low budget movie, even then.
It is, yeah. And I was like, dude, this looks a little too clean to be fucking Detroit. Sure enough, I was right. The main thing I was gonna say is I GPS'd Cleveland, Ohio, to where Cobalt Hall was. Yeah, that's drivable. That's something you would definitely do. I've made that drive to go to a concert
from Cleveland
to
Detroit.
The farthest I had to drive myself. It was like 2.5 hours up north to Alpine Valley in Wisconsin to go see Van Halen in 98. So it makes sense for these kids to drive 2.5 hours because it's a 2.5 hour drive for them to go see fucking Kiss in Michigan.
There were a couple of things I enjoyed. Okay.
Okay.
I really enjoyed Eddie Furlong. I think he's great. You know, he's John O'Connor. That matters anymore because now he's dead. But
now he was under at the time, though. I think he was up. Okay, this is unofficial here. Did you notice he did a lot of New Line Cinema movies in the late 90s, early aughts?
Yeah, he did Pecker, right? For John Waters.
Yeah, he did Pecker. He did.
No, it's just that his character, John Connor, is dead now because of Terminator Dark Fate.
Right.
They killed
him.
Well,
I was mainly saying I think that Eddie Furlong was kind of sort of under contract from New Line because he was in a bunch of New Line productions.
Well, maybe he had. Yeah, maybe he had first look. Maybe they liked him. And also, I think John Waters liked him because he cast him as. He was really great in that movie. Pecker is an awesome movie. Everybody should go see it. I love that film. My wife turned me on to it.
I think it's a really good movie too. I mean, I think Eddie Furlong could have had a great career.
He's kind of, I don't know what happened. Yeah, he kind of, I mean, like what you see in the movie, I think is the real Ed Furlong there. He's kind of, he kind of got into substances and all that stuff. The other people in the movie are practically unknown, except for Melanie Lynskey, who turned into a babe in this movie. I remember watching it the first time. I was like, holy shit, that's that chubby girl from Heavenly Creatures. She turned into a babe.
Oh, no, I made the good joke. I had my friends over last night watching. I'm like, yeah, she's going to move to Ann Arbor. I'm like, no, she's going to move over to California and become Charlie Harper's neighbor and fucking stalk his ass.
I saw.
But the other actor.
I forgot there was another one.
I like the other actors. Giuseppe Andrews, he popped up in a few other movies. He was in American Pie.
Which one is he?
He actually popped up
which
in American.
Which one is he?
He was the kid who his mom owned the car.
Oh, he was the kid with the short blonde hair, right?
No, that's Jam. That's Jam.
Okay,
He was the kid who goes, your ass is a Ralpo. He had to go recover his mom's stolen car.
Oh, okay, and he hooks up with Natasha Lyonne?
Yeah, he hooks up with Natasha Lyonne. Yeah.
Right, and she's the other one who gets
a
name.
The other one, James DeBello, he was in, again, he
which
popped
one's
up
he?
In America.
Is he the short one here?
Trip, he's Trip.
Is he the one with the crazy mom?
Yeah, the stoner guy. It's like, if it wasn't for your mom, we wouldn't have gotten that fine Panama Red last night.
Oh, wait, well, no, what about the one whose mom was a Carpenters fan? Remember, she tried
that's Jam's mom. That's the crazy religious bitch mother. That's Lynn Shay.
Lynn Shay.
No, I'm talking about the side characters. Like I said, I'm talking about...
Now,
fucking...
wasn't Lynn Shay in another movie? Wasn't she in a Nightmare on Elm Street movie?
Yes, she was. She's Bob Shay's sister.
And she was in a Nightmare on Elm Street movie, though, too, right?
She was in the first one. She played the teacher.
Okay, gotcha.
She gave
I figured she was related to Bob Shay for being in a New Line.
Yeah, she was also in Kingpin. She was also in There's Something About Mary. You know, the Farrelly brothers found her.
All right,
her
now what about the kid who wants to be Jason Mewes so bad but isn't?
That's I was getting to him. That's James DeBello. He was in a bit part in American Pie when fucking Jason Biggs is stripping in front of his computer. He's one of the people that can see the whole podcast. Again, it's a bit part.
Okay.
His biggest role that I remember is Cabin Fever from 2002.
See, okay, now the thing about this is he doesn't have Muse's charm. Muse can get away with doing a lot of things, like, you know, getting a boner because God is Alanis Morissette. He can get away with that kind of shit. This kid can't really do it. He kind of comes off a little bit weird for me, for my taste.
You know, the funny thing is, I never made comparisons to Jason Mewes. And what's ironic now that we're talking, you are the second person in 24 hours who has made Jason Mewes comparisons to this character.
He kind of just reminds me. He reminds me of, he reminds me of Jay from Jay and Silent Bob.
I am not reminded.
What the
him
fuck happened
see,
to that guy's head? You know?
This guy is just, because Jay at least has some eloquence to him at the end of the day. This character has none. He's a fucking idiot.
Yeah, he gets into they all have their own separate adventures, so there's a little bit of American Graffiti going on. They kind of split up trying to get to, they keep, every time they get tickets, they wind up not getting tickets. Until they finally, I guess, these kids, this little kid who's dressed up like Ace Frehley with his thugs beat them up or some trade, take their tickets.
Nope. Again, I thought you just watched this.
I just watched the movie, but it's really hard to keep track of what the fuck is going on.
You are butchering the ending. No, they come back from their adventures, you know, their separate adventures, and they say, "Did you get any tickets? You get any tickets?" You're like, "No." And then Jam's like, "Hey, I got an idea. Let's beat the shit out of each other. And then let's just say luck. They have to let us in right there."
I saw
and
that. What they
okay, what ended up happening was fucking stoner boy, fucking Trip, was going to mug the little kid dressed up like Ace Frehley for his KISS ticket. Turned out he had, you know, a posse with him.
Yeah,
and then they
yeah.
said, okay, in order to not get beat up, you got to get us $200.
Right.
That's when he gets the $200 from the gas station. They fucking punch him anyway, and they take his fucking wallet. After they beat the shit out of each other, they go to Cobo Hall.
Yeah, and then they go to the security, and they say, "Those guys stole our tickets. He's got my wallet. Look."
Yeah, so it was all happenstance. And this gets into another argument. Not an argument, but this is a problem I had with the movie. The movie, at the end of the day, the term "in a nutshell" is all around this movie. This movie wraps everything up a little too nice and neat.
Well, yeah.
This movie is very convenient. Like, every situation they're put into, it's convenience. It's serendipitous. Everything works out for them in the long run.
There are, I just, you know how I would have done it? I would have done it differently. I would not have done it in a kind of rock and roll, high school, dazed and confused, pastiche. You know what I would have done? I would have done, if I were forced to write a screenplay about this, and I was explaining it to my wife too, I said, the big hysteria around KISS at the time was figuring out what they look like. So I would have been like, there's a contest, you get $5,000 if you can get pictures of all four members of KISS without their makeup on, and then have people running around trying to get their picture. Make it a little closer to "I Want to Hold Your Hand," you know, the Beatles movie that Zemeckis made.
Right.
You know? And do something along those lines rather than just trying to get to a concert. It just seemed...
No, that makes a lot of sense, and I think that would have made for a really good movie. Like,
it could have been like a great, like, people beating each other up to get pictures of these guys, right?
Yeah, because then, like, the way is, if they would have won that radio contest like they were supposed to, they would have had backstage passes. Now, they probably would have never met KISS outside of the makeup, but... You know, that goes without saying.
But then, I mean, it would have ended like on a joke, because it would have been like, "Their pictures, we got the pictures, they're in the paper." And then they open up the paper and they go, "Ugh." You know, and then cut the credits right there. And then that would have been it.
Kind of like how Fanboys ended. Wait, what if it sucks?
Yeah. That's how, but I mean, there's a lot here to really enjoy about the movie.
Ironically enough, why I mentioned Fanboys, that same fucking actor, Sam Huntington, he's in Fanboys too. I forgot about that.
Yeah.
He's in that movie too. You know, and he was an actor that could have had a decent career, but he just made a lot of bad decisions in scripts that he got. I mean, if
there's a lot of times though. Yeah. I mean, it's a hard juggle to try and figure out, okay, which project is going to be the one that hits, because there are some things that look terrible on paper but become enormous hits, and then there are things that look great on paper and are terrible. Right.
Well, it also didn't help that his first main role as an actor was in Jungle to Jungle.
I vaguely remember that from a video box.
It was a remake of Little Indian Big City, basically about how Tim Allen's character is like this fucking, let's just say, for a businessman or whatever, and he had a relationship with a girl who was in a different continent. He had a kid he didn't know about, and the kid was raised by Aborigines, and he became like a little mini Tarzan or some shit like that.
Oh, for crying in a beer.
That and it's sad.
That sounds like one of those wacky, screwball, quirky comedies from the 90s.
And it was. And the sad part is, I was watching the old Siskel and Ebert review, that it was funny. They go, "The worst movie of 1997 is a remake of one of the worst movies of 1995. It's just like, wow, okay. So why the hell would you want to remake a bad movie to begin with and Tim Allen it up?
Tim Allen.
And then you put this poor kid in a role and he can't even have a good career because now people are like, "Oh, you were in that Jungle to Jungle movie. Yeah, we don't want to work with you. Fuck off."
Christ. All right. We got to wrap this up. It's almost 10
o'clock. I know you wanted it. But you know what? At the end of the day, Detroit Rock City will always have a special place in my heart because it is not one of my favorite comedies. It is, by any stretch of the imagination, it's not a great movie. But at the same time, if you're looking to watch a decent Adam Rifkin flick, it's not that bad. I mean, there are 100, 200 worse movies out there other than Detroit Rock City. I can think of 200 movies I would rather not watch.
Yeah.
Detroit Rock City is a fun type movie.
You know what? I said the same thing even watching Kiss Meets the Phantom, okay? The thing about Kiss Meets the Phantom and Detroit Rock City, they're not pretending to be anything more than what they actually are. They're really stupid, goofy, funny kind of movies, and they provide entertainment. I mean, shit, fucking Kiss Meets the Phantom Park is still better than Ad fucking Astra, okay? And it's better than Tenet. Sorry, but it is. Because at least it tries to entertain, and fucking Detroit Rock City does, too.
Detroit Rock City did entertain me, and I think, and you know what, this is the reason I told you it holds a special place. If not for that movie, I would not know who Kiss is.
I can't.
We wouldn't even, we would not be having this discussion right now.
I can't believe you said that, because, I mean, like, Kiss is iconic. I mean, the whole thing about Kiss
because
is very iconic.
Back in 99, I was balls deep in my Metallica phase. Fucking, I had just come out of my Aerosmith phase. I was in my fucking Metallica phase.
What do you get to be my age, young man? When you get to be my age, you're going to love all kinds of music, and you're not going to be afraid to admit it. I listen to all kinds of music now. I mean, it doesn't even matter. I'll listen to Anthrax, and then I'll listen to fucking Dolly Parton. And then I'll listen to Whitney Houston, Janet Jackson, I listen to Madonna. I'll listen to Rush, Anthrax, Van Halen, Conway Twitty.
Man, I am 10 years removed from you, and I do the same thing you do. Again, that's the difference between being a dumb 17-year-old kid and a freaking 38-year-old adult. At least my tastes have grown. And I can, like you, I can listen to a metal song 1 minute and an 80s pop song the next. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, like, nowadays, I just care. I like listening to music. It makes me feel good. It makes me feel good to hear
right.
some stuff. And I don't care anymore what kind of music it is. I really don't care. I'm not stuck in a genre. I know when you're a kid, you tend to be a little embarrassed, you know, because you want your friends to think that you're into the same stuff that they're into, and you're cool that way because of peer pressure and all that. But you know.
Right. Most of the time, see, that was the thing. I didn't care. A lot of people, like, dude, I listened. I actually enjoyed.
I mean, I took a lot of shit. I took a lot of shit for being a Kiss fan. I really did.
Oh,
I took
shit my late junior and senior year because I switched up listening to classic rock. That's when I started listening to Kiss. I started becoming a Styx. Like, right around that time, Styx and Kiss were, like, the two bands I was listening to the most.
Speaking of which, they played Come Sail Away on the soundtrack.
Yep, exactly. So,
sailing away. Your high voice bested you.
So, yeah, thank you, Adam Rifkin. Thank you to Detroit Rock City for making me a Kiss fan and letting me know about this great band that I, if not for this movie, I would have probably wrote off.
And thank you to Gordon Hessler for making us laugh at Love again.